Saverick Baptist Church, you're very welcome on this Sunday evening to your gospel service. We're going to praise the Lord now, and we just thank you from your own homes that you can praise the Lord in your own hearts. So let's raise our voices along with us, our opening hymn of praise tonight, to the glory of our Lord and Saviour. Wonderful to worship the Lord, isn't it? We're going to deal now with the prayer and the announcements. And just firstly, as we go to pray, last weekend, a dear brother in the Lord, Hugh Sloan. Now, Hugh was originally from Dunseverick, originally from this church, indeed his brother Sam, many will remember as well, went out to be a missionary in Peru. And Hugh passed away. Sam's already in glory. Hugh passed away last weekend. He was living up in Cookstown, and we express our sympathy and our condolences to his wife and to the whole family circle, and the family circle that lives still in this area around the North Coast and around Dunseverick Church. So may the Lord be with you and comfort you at this time. Let's now unite our hearts in prayer. If we want to know God's blessing upon this meeting, well, we need the Lord's presence, so we do tonight. Dear Lord, we thank you for our time this evening. And Lord Jesus, we come into your presence acknowledging that, Lord, in and of myself and ourselves, we have nothing to offer, but what has been offered at the place called Calvary is all that we need. We thank you for your saving grace and how there upon the cross of Calvary, Jesus died to save our souls. We thank you for the shedding of thy blood. And Lord, we just thank you tonight that that saving grace still reaches out to men and women, boys and girls throughout not only our community here in the North Antrim Coast, but our country of Northern Ireland, our land of Ireland, and then beyond to the uttermost parts of the world. Lord, we ask, Lord, tonight that you would bless this service and all who take part in it, that your name be uplifted and glorified. Lord Jesus, we ask as well that your sustaining grace would be the portion of each one who tonight, Lord, is sorrowing. We think of that Sloan family and the wider family connection, both up in Cookstown and in our own area here, that you would just pour in the oil of comfort to their hearts and that they might know thy sustaining grace at this time. Lord Jesus, there are others in our own fellowship who have known illness and infirmity over this past while, and they too need your touch in body. Indeed, Lord, there have been those connected with our fellowship, like everywhere else, who have contracted coronavirus, and thankfully, Lord, most of them are on the mend, but we pray, Lord, that you would continue to heal. Lord, we just bring before you our work here in Dunseverick and the different outreaches, whether online or our morning drive-in service, that you would continue to bless the work of God here and the word of God, as you would throughout our province, and particularly, Lord, in connection tonight as we think about missions and the land of Romania and our brother Tommy Wright and those who are associated with the mission that he represents, that we're going to hear of by and by. Just bless that work as you would our own, and indeed of Baptist missions in Peru, Spain, France, and throughout Ireland as well. In Jesus, our wonderful Saviour's name, amen. Amen. With regards announcements then, I just want to thank all those who come along again to our drive-in service each Sunday morning during lockdown, and of course, we were doing drive-ins last year as well, and it has been a real time of blessing, and it's great to see the car park so well filled, even though the weather at times can be slightly inclement for us in the back of the potato lorry. But I hope that all who come along enjoy in the comfort of their car the word of God and the worship of God. Thank you for supporting that ministry. And also for those who support our online ministry, whether that's comments there to encourage us or just by watching, thank you for watching tonight and choosing to take the time to join us in our evening service. With regards to our own folks, our sister Jean Jenkins has now got out of hospital, and we are very glad about that, and she's now recovering, so she is, and ask for your prayers. Also, then our sister Sarah McConachy continues to do exceedingly well at home, and we give thanks unto the Lord for that. With regards then, announcements and church meetings, do remember, ladies, particularly Tuesday night, ladies, is your fellowship meeting. Of course, that is online, and that will be on our YouTube channel. You'll find that through Facebook and on YouTube. That's at 8 p.m. Tuesday night. And the speaker this week is Vi Dawson. And you can really look forward to that. Vi's an excellent speaker. And I know, ladies, you'll be blessed through that ministry Tuesday. Then on Wednesday, we return to our Bible study, Revelation Revealed. We're in chapter 11. And last year, President Trump, as he was then President of the United States, now Biden, he signed historical Abram agreements, they were called the Abrahamic agreements between Israel and some of its neighboring nations. And friends, you're going to find in chapter 11 of Revelation, those agreements are going to be broken. Yeah. We're going to find that. We're going to hear about the two witnesses in Jerusalem, a very, very exciting chapter in the book of Revelation as we look towards the future and the time known as the Great Tribulation. So you can look forward to that, and that's on at 8 p.m. Facebook Live stream on Wednesday night. Then do remember, for our teens, there's teen devotions, and also then our thought for the day that goes on our Facebook page every morning around about 9 o'clock in the morning. And I thank those who help out with that on the technical end. All that work that you do, guys, is very much appreciated. That's really all by way of announcements. So it is, and of course they're all made according to the good purpose of our Lord. But tonight we have taken part two people in a sense. Firstly, whenever I conclude with these announcements, we're going to hear from our brother Tommy Wright. Tommy comes from the Glens of Antrim, is well known here in this church in Dunsavrick and supported by us, and he has a ministry in Romania, and he recorded a clip for us updating us on that work, and I think you'll really enjoy hearing what they're doing and what they have been doing in the land of Romania. Then our brother John Porter, one of our own, one of our deacons here in the church who leads worship here, he is going to bring a piece in ministry and song to our hearts, and then you'll return to me. So over to Tommy. Thank you, Tommy, for taking the time to record this video for us, and God bless.
Well, hello to the folks up at Dunsavrick. If this picture tells us anything, it tells us just how quickly time goes. Also reminds us of the faithfulness of the folks up at Dunsavrick and supporting the shoebox ministry over the years. This goes back to 2005, this picture. I don't know, maybe the shoebox has started just before then. So I just want to take this opportunity to thank you, your present pastor, oversight, and all the members for your support, and not least for your very generous gift just recently to help with the transport of the shoeboxes. Now, the shoeboxes were very different this year. We knew it was going to be different from the start. So Jackie went to the barn in the first lockdown in March, and thankfully with an awful lot of material carried over from last year, so she was able to start packing right away, and she's been there right through the summer until early October. We've got them all bagged up and ready, the pallets built and ready to go. As you can see, the ladies now get handbags. They're better because once they use the contents of the handbags, they have the handbag left over. So they're all packed up and ready to go, and God willing, they'll ship on Friday the 30th of October from Hamill's store up in the Braid, and they'll take about 8 to 12 days to travel. So just recover your prayers for safe journeying for them. There's lots could go wrong in the transport, and it'll be good if they get there safely. Then they'll be stored from now until Christmas. We're shipping early because there's so much uncertainty about shipping and Brexit and COVID, so we want to be sure and get them into Romania. Now, you could be forgiven for thinking that it's Romanian 602 ministry, they do shoeboxes, but there's an awful lot more goes on than shoeboxes. In fact, the shoeboxes, they're the most visible and certainly the most physical of the ministry, but it just represents about a quarter or 25% of what we're trying to do in Romania. This wee video here tells 1,000 words. This is the children coming back to the church for the day club, after school club, after the first lockdown, and they heard that Ioana was going back up to open the day club again, and this is them all running back to the church, and it's just lovely to see their enthusiasm and their excitement. Of course, the day club involves feeding, lots of feeding the children. Many of these children don't get a square meal throughout the day, but also more importantly, it involves teaching. They get help with homeworks when they're at school. They also got Bible lessons, and this is Joanna's full-time ministry. Every morning she prepares food, takes it up there about 30 kilometres away, her and her husband. Spends most of the day up there preparing with the children, and then comes back home again. So that's her ministry at the minute. Of course, this ministry leads into church, and that's the whole aim of the thing, to get them into a Christian environment where the Word of God can be taught to them. Sometimes they meet outside. There's three locations. This is the container church. Containers get really warm in the summertime, so most of the summer they'll meet outside. The mayor's given us a very large compound, about an acre in total. So they meet out there, and do their Bible classes and lessons during the summer. It's just great to see, you know, from your own personal experience, you know, you've taught Sunday school for years, and it seems only a blink from your teaching children in Sunday school until you're teaching their children. And this is the whole idea, to build up a real rapport with these children in the village, to try and get them out of the deprivation they're living in, to get them away from the sinful lives, to show them the gospel, teach them the gospel, get them to try and trust, put faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, so that we can continue this on from one generation to the next. This here was an outreach we were doing. We hired this big hall, an outreach for all the children. This was before the COVID came in. This is a different church situation here. There's Gusty. Gusty in full flow. Boys and girls. It's always good to have a programme. I find when I go to Romania, nearly always, they'll have a programme. They call it a programme, but really what it entails is a few folks standing up at the front and singing, maybe a couple of pieces, maybe someone will have a poem. I think it's good. It adds interest and it creates ownership when you have people involved in the service. Still a lot of deprivation in Romania. I just don't know the circumstances of this lady. But as you can see, she's not in a good environment here. And this one here is not much better. This here takes some of the older ones of us back to the days whenever we were feeding sticks into the modern mistress. And that's another thing we'll be doing now, God willing, coming up to Christmas. We do send out about £2,500 per quarter just to support what's all going on here, the feeding programme, helping with fuel. We will be buying loads and loads of sticks now for the church members and different difficult families coming into the winter. And that's something we want to try and continue. Here these kids have managed to get a hold of some bags of face masks, and they're taking them back to the village. This here photo was taken, this is last year's shoeboxes, and it's always good to get the shoeboxes. Here's a lady, Jackie actually remembers filling this handbag last year, and as you can see, her husband's got a shoebox. So we feel that the shoebox ministry is coming to an end. We think it's had a season due to export restrictions, COVID, and so the uncertainty that's about. But certainly all the other ministry that's going on, we really want to continue to invest in that because we think that's really important to support our folks and help them financially and spiritually and prayerfully as we continue this ministry. We'll lose the shoebox ministry, but we don't want to let this other ministry go because we feel that's really, really important. So thank you again for partnering with us, and thanks again for the support you give us. And we just wish you all the best, and stay safe, and God bless. Thank you. Bye.
Tempted and tried, we oft made to wonder why it should. Taken our loved ones. our home so lonely and drear, then do we wonder why others prosper, living so wicked year after year. Farther along we'll know all about it. Farther cheer up, my brother, live in his sunshine. We'll understand it all by and by. Faithful till death, said our loving Master. A few more days to labor and wait. Toils of the road will then as nothing, as we sweep through those beautiful gates. Farther along we'll know more about it. Farther understand why. Cheer up, my brother, live in the sunshine. We'll understand it all by and by. Cheer up, my brother, live in his sunshine. We'll understand it all by and by. Thank you,
Tommy, and what an encouragement it is to hear, and a challenge it is to hear about the work of the Lord in Romania. And also our brother John Porter, thank you, John, for taking the time and recording that piece for us, and it really did bless our hearts. If you have your Bible, turn with me to John's Gospel, chapter 10. For those who have been watching on a Sunday evening, you know that I have been doing over this past few weeks a series, The Sayings of Jesus in John's Gospel. We're looking at the I Ams of the Lord. And we come to the fourth of them tonight, and it's found in John chapter 10, and we're going to read from verse 11. John chapter 10, verse 11. Jesus speaking says, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd giveth his life for the sheep. But he that is a hireling and not the shepherd, whose own sheep are not, seeth the wolf coming and leaveth the sheep and fleeth. And the wolf catches them and scattereth the sheep. The hireling fleeth because he is a hireling and careth not for the sheep. I am the good shepherd, and know my sheep, and am known of mine. As the Father knoweth me, even so know I the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. And we conclude our reading at verse 15. Trust that the Lord will bless it to our hearts. Last week we looked at the saying of Jesus there in John 10 and verse 9, principally, I am the door. And we saw that Jesus was the door that opens to salvation. Tonight he says, I am the good shepherd. And that good shepherd is the one who saves us by his grace. The reason that Jesus uses this illustration, remember chapter 8, chapter 9 and chapter 10, they're all interlinked, they're around the same period. And Jesus was dealing with the scribes and the Pharisees, the religious leaders of Judaism in Jerusalem. And they were meant to be the shepherds of the flock of Israel. But in reality, like the hireling that Jesus speaks of in verse 12, they had abandoned the flock. They had abandoned their duty. You see, they were pasturing the flock out of a career rather than out of a calling by God. And for those scribes and Pharisees, they were more concerned about their status in society rather than the lost souls of the sheep of their flock. Friends, they were full of pride. Remember the parable that Jesus told in Luke chapter 18 of the Pharisee and the publican who went up to the temple to pray. And the Pharisee looking up at heaven and almost patting himself on the back at the same time, looking then in the far corner of the temple, spied the publican and said, Lord, I thank thee that I'm not as that man. You see, they were very, very proud, so they were. And they viewed those lost sheep, they viewed them as being pests. And they were lost, they were lame, and they were lonely, and there were many of them. And that's why Jesus Christ came into the world to save sinners. And they said of Jesus in a derogatory fashion in Luke chapter 15 that this man receiveth sinners. They might have said it in a derogatory fashion, but tonight I say hallelujah. This man receiveth sinners and still does tonight. And he'll receive you if you come. Friends, we want to see two things tonight. Lessons about the sheep. Because to be a shepherd, you had to shepherd or pastor the flock. Well, the first thing that I want you to notice is that sheep need refreshment. If we go back into John 10 and verse 3 and 4, we're reminded there that he calls his own sheep. And he says, and when he putteth forth his own sheep, he goeth before them, and the sheep follow him, and for they know his voice. The sheep need refreshment, and it's up to the shepherd to help provide that. He provides it in the sense that the sheepfold there, in which he himself personally is the door, it's there for their safety, for their entrance and for their exit. But he also calls his sheep. So he cares for them for their safety, but he calls for them as well. He leads them into the safety of the fold. But then he says in verse 4, he leads them out to sustenance in the field. Have you heard the Lord's voice speaking to you? If you said to me, Pastor, what it's like, well then, if you have to ask that question, you've already answered mine, so you have, because you haven't heard it, because it's a distinct voice. The Lord's voice, when you hear it, you know it. And so, the Lord equated his voice with that of the shepherd and the sheep, calling them, guiding them, guarding them. And of course, Jesus issues a call for you and me to come out of our sin when he says, come unto me, all ye that labor under heavy burden, and I will give you rest. And that, when we come unto him, leads us, we might say, out into the green pastures of redemption and righteousness where Jesus saves us. Friends, the sheep need refreshment. But Jesus is going to remind us of something else here tonight. The sheep also need rescuing. I don't know if you have had much experience with sheep farming, but there are certain breeds that are very wild. One of them is Kerry Hills. And the Kerry Hills can jump as high as any thoroughbred jumping horse. It can jump fences, it can jump you and me without a problem. So there are those sheep that are wild, but only a few of them. But friends, one thing that sheep have in common is that they are wanderers, that they are prone to wander. And Jesus mentions in our text, they're a predator that they face. He says in verse 12, there about the hireling there, the false shepherd, who when the wolf cometh, leaveth the sheep and flees, and the wolf catches them and scattereth the sheep. That's a predator. You see, that's the danger without. And there is a predator for you and for me. The psalmist refers to us as being the sheep of his flock. And I tell you, that predator scatters the sheep all over the place, because that predator is Satan himself. And he seeks to devour, the Lord says. He seeks to destroy. And friends, he would do that in your life and mine if we are not committed to Christ and converted by the Lord Jesus Christ. So friends, there's the predator, the wolf that's mentioned here, without. But there's also parasites. If you remember back to the 23rd Psalm, the shepherd's psalm that's often referred to, it says in verse 5 there, thou preparest the table before me in the presence of mine enemies. And the picture there is of a huge granite stone on a raised area, a platform we might say. And upon that, the shepherd would leave the meal for the sheep. Today, shepherds or farmers use troughs, and they'll put the meal into them, and they're raised structure, normally metal now, used to be wooden, and they're raised from the ground because the parasites live in the ground. And the picture here is, there thou preparest the table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Well, there's a practical table, we would say there. So that raised platform there, the parasites are there, but they're not going to touch. They're not going to harm. They're not going to contaminate. You see, the wolf was a predator from without. The parasite is something that actually the sheep digest and within, and can destroy them just as a predator could. And friends, there's that practical application there, but also a prophetical one, because there's a picture here of the great supper of the Lamb in the book of Revelation, and how the world there will look on, and you and I will be in glory at that great feast, and the world will be heading to that great fire because they have rejected the Saviour. Friends, the sheep need rescuing. And didn't Jesus say that in Luke chapter 19 and verse 10? Remember the story of Zacchaeus, that wee man couldn't see the Lord. He climbed up the sycamore tree, and then he hung over it, and Jesus bid him come down, and he was going to his home, and Jesus not only went into his home, but into his heart, and he was saved. And the Lord said of him, for the Son of Man is come to seek and to save that which was lost. Zacchaeus was lost, and Jesus sought him, found him, and saved him. Has he saved you? Friends, those are two lessons about the sheep. Many more you could apply, but they're the two for tonight. We also then want to see a lesson from the shepherd, because Jesus says, I am the good shepherd. Now, for his audience, they would be well aware of their Old Testament history and Bible. And they would have been familiar with some of the Old Testament shepherds. They would have known about Abel in Genesis 4 and the sacrifice of the lamb. They would have known about Abraham in Genesis 22 and the substitution of the lamb. They would have known about Moses in the beginning of the book of Exodus and his shepherding of the lambs when God spoke to him out of the burning bush. They would have known about David and David's saving of the lambs. Remember how the lion and the bear come and David defended the lambs there and took them and saved them from the paws of death, we would say. And then there's Isaiah as well in the Old Testament, the prophet Isaiah. And they would have known about his picture in Isaiah 53 of the suffering of the lamb. So when Jesus spoke here, these people listened. They understood that he was saying something important about being a shepherd. Firstly, he was telling them about his divinity. Jesus said, I am. Of course, each and every one of these statements begins with that word. What is the significance of it? Well, when you go back to the book of Exodus, when God revealed himself to Moses, and Moses felt that he wasn't eloquent, that he wasn't up to leading the children of Israel, and he says unto the Lord, Lord, if they ask me who has spoken to me, what am I going to say? How am I going to describe it? They'll think I'm mad when I say I was speaking to Yahweh, I was speaking to God. And he simply said to Moses, tell them, I am that I am. This was God speaking of his own person. And so every time you find the Lord Jesus using that statement, I am, it was calling the people's attention to his divinity, that they would understand that Jesus was God incarnate, that Jesus had come into the world to save sinners. Firstly, I am and his divinity. Then secondly, his devotion. I am the good shepherd. His devotion. You see, whenever we think of the shepherd, what's the difference between a good shepherd and a bad one? Well, firstly, I tell you, the good shepherd, the Lord Jesus, knows his sheep by name when he calls them. He's already told us that in verse 3. To him the porter openeth, and the sheep hear his voice, and he calleth his own sheep by name and leadeth them out. You see, the picture is here, within the sheepfold or the sheep pen, there's a whole huddle of flocks, not just one, two, but maybe five or more. And that's why we sing at Christmas, while shepherds watch their flocks by night. The shepherds just weren't watching the one flock. Each one had a flock. They were all within the sheepfold. But once that shepherd called his sheep, they automatically got up, shook themselves, and walked out and followed him. Friends, the shepherd, he was devoted because he knew his sheep by name. Does Isaiah not tell us that? That the Lord knows his own? Have I not redeemed thee? Isaiah 43 and verse 1. I have called thee by thy name. Thou art mine. So firstly, he was devoted in that he calls his own sheep by name. But also, he's devoted in the good shepherd that he knows his own sheep by nature. And he doesn't only call them, but he cares for them. He provides for them. He knows this about sheep. For all we like sheep have gone astray. And that's why the Lord Jesus, the Good Shepherd, was devoted in calling his sheep and in caring for his sheep. Friends, his deity, his devotion, finally his death. The Good Shepherd giveth his life for the sheep. Jesus was saying to them, I am the Lamb of God, and I will go to the altar of sacrifice on your behalf. Friends, there he would suffer scourging and shame for their sake. There he would be sacrificed for their salvation and ours as well. The hymn writer said, but none of the ransomed ever knew how deep were the waters crossed, or how dark was the night which the Lord passed through, ere he found his sheep that was lost. Out in the bleak desert he heard its cry, all bleeding and helpless and ready to die. The Lord Jesus, he uses that very imagery in the parable that he tells in Luke chapter 15 of the lost sheep. Remember, there's the lost sheep, the lost silver, the lost son. But in verses 3 through to 7, he speaks about the lost sheep. And the first thing we notice, there's this straying sheep. One out of 100. And many might say, but sure, it's only one. You speak to any sheep farmer or any farmer that has cattle, and I tell you now, should he have 1,000, he still cares for the one. And so even though it was only one, friends, there, that one had lost its guide. It had lost its guard. It had lost its guarantee of life. And it was out in the wilderness, alone and bare, and about to perish. That's a picture of the sinner. And how at times we think we can manage on our own. And we can do without this and that and without the Lord. And then problems come. And we can't understand, we can't fathom them, and we don't have strength for them or enablement against them. And we are burdened and we're broken. And friends, there's only one to whom we can come, and that is the Lord Jesus, who takes away the burden of sin, the burden of strife in your life and mine. And friends, firstly, there was the straying sheep. Then you have the seeking shepherd, don't you? And he left the 99 within the fold, and he sought after that one which was lost. You can imagine the seeking up into the high mountains, down into the low valleys, away as far as he could go, to the east and to the west, to the north and the south. No distance would be too great. No danger would be too great. He never stopped looking. He never stopped loving that sheep. Not as a picture of the shepherd, and he's seeking for you tonight. You, my friend, who are lost. You, my friend, who are lame. You, my friend, tonight, who are backslidden. Jesus seeks after you. He seeks for the backslider to restore you to your first love, and that your heart again may well up with the joy and the praise of the Lord. For you, dear friend, who have never known the embrace of Jesus and the empowerment of the Lord in your life and the removal of the stain of sin of your heart, Jesus seeks you where you are, in your own home tonight. Wherever you would be watching on this service, Jesus is seeking you. He seeks after the lost to redeem them. He seeks after the lame to restore them. And he's seeking after you. Friends, then there was the salvation of the sheep. Do you notice in that story that when the shepherd finds the sheep lost and lame, what does he do? Does he take it and give it a scolding? Does he get a staff and beat it? No, he doesn't. Upon his shoulders, he takes and lays it. What's he doing? He's taking the full weight of that sheep upon himself. Just as he takes the full weight and the burden of our sin upon his own body on the tree. That is a picture of Jesus. And as he comes home rejoicing. And he calls the neighbours. And he calls the friends. And he says, look, this sheep of mine which is lost has been found. And there was rejoicing. And the Lord went on to say, not only rejoicing there, but it was a description of the lost sinner who the Lord has found, who the Lord has saved. And he says that there will be singing and praise in heaven amongst the angelic host over one sinner who repents. I wonder tonight, will you be that one sinner who repents? That you would cause that angelic host to be praising the Lord over your salvation. I hope and pray that you are. Friends, as I conclude this message, Jesus, we read in verse 15, he says, and I laid down my life for the sheep. Do you realize, as we think of this lesson of the shepherd, how he looked out for us? Oh, how he longed after us, how he loved us, and how when he finds us, he lifts us with joy and takes us home. The 23rd Psalm, it's often equated with this verse, the Lord is my shepherd, is known throughout the world. I have heard it recited, I have heard it sang, I have heard it preached in a number of languages. There's a story told, and with this I conclude my message tonight. Many years ago, in a theatre in London, in the West End, a great orator came along, and amongst the many things that he spoke on that night was the 23rd Psalm, and he recited it. And such was his passion for it, etc., that when he come to the end of it in verse 6, he bowed his head and the crowd assembled there stood up and to a man and woman applauded him. What a piece of oratory. When they sat down and silence then come upon that assembled gathering, there was an elderly man seated near the front who raised his hand. And he said, sir, I also know that Psalm 23, could I come up on stage and recite it? And the orator said, of course, sir, come on ahead. Brought him up the steps round the side, and there he began to recite it. Stillness came over the audience. When he finished in verse 6, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever, amen. The crowd did not stand and applaud this time, but many were sitting and weeping. And the orator came and placed his hand upon the elderly man's shoulder. And he said, friends, you know what the difference is here tonight? I know the psalm. This man, he knows the shepherd. Can I ask you, do you know the Lord Jesus, the good shepherd who giveth his life for the sheep? Do you know about him? That's great. But that'll never save you. You must know him as your own and personal saviour tonight. He gave his life for you at Calvary. Jesus said, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd giveth his life. Instead of sheep, put your name in there. He done it for you. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for your word tonight. And we pray, Lord, that if there's anyone at home tonight watching on, Lord, that your spirit might be convicting them at this time. Because we see, Lord, your great longing for men and women, boys and girls, is that none should perish and all would come to a knowledge of thee. And Lord, we see that that longing, Lord Jesus, meant that you went out looking and you sought for the lost sheep, and you still do tonight, Lord. And we pray, Lord, that there would be singing as well over one lost sheep, one sinner, who would be reconciled to the Lord if they're backslidden, or redeemed by the Lord if they're unsaved tonight. Lord, give deciding grace, we pray. And we just ask, Lord, that the whole of the meeting, what Tommy brought to us, Lord, about Romania, what John brought to us in the ministry of song, and your word would speak to hearts and would lead to the salvation of a soul. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Friends, as we conclude our service tonight again, many, many thanks for joining us this Sunday evening. May the Lord continue to bless you and to keep you. And our prayer is that you'll join us again during the week. Tuesday night for the ladies' meeting with I. Dawson. Wednesday night then for Revelation Revealed, looking at Revelation chapter 11. And then the other online ministries there as well. And then back to next Lord's Day. Let's just pray now and close our time in prayer. And then we'll sing our final hymn. Dear Lord, thank you for your word to our hearts tonight in song. Also, Lord, the challenge of mission, as we have heard about the work ongoing in Romania, and we pray bless that. And also, Lord Jesus, for your word to our hearts tonight, and your own saying, I am the good shepherd giveth his life for the sheep. May it be that there will be those listening on tonight, watching, Lord, who will trust in Jesus as their own and personal Saviour. Bless us, Lord, and keep your hand upon us throughout the incoming days of this new week. Not only us here in the church, but our community up around the North Antrim coast, and indeed our country and then beyond. In Jesus, our Saviour's name. Amen. Thank you again for watching. Good night and God bless. Let us now unite our hearts in praise with our final hymn. Good night.